Hi, I'm Corporal Scott Pesca. Join Petty Officer Christina Brockman and me on Navy Marine Corps News. This week, sailors aboard USS Portsmouth show off their submarine to actors from the new hit World War II submarine movie, U-571. USS Mobile Bay sailors prepare for flight deck fires with a realistic land-based trainer in Yokosuka. And sailors aboard USS Incheon swing to a Latin beat when the TV dance show Caliente broadcasts from the flight deck. These stories and more on Navy Marine Corps News.
This week on Navy Marine Corps News, sailors aboard USS Portsmouth show off their submarine to actors from the new hit World War II submarine movie, U-571. USS Mobile Bay sailors prepare for flight deck fires with a realistic land-based trainer in Yokosuka. And sailors aboard USS Incheon swing to a Latin beat when the TV dance show Caliente broadcasts from the flight deck. These stories and more next on Navy Marine Corps News.
Hi, everybody. I'm Tommy Lasorda, Senior Vice President of the Los Angeles Dodgers. I watch the Navy Marine Corps News. It's great.
Welcome to Navy Marine Corps News. I'm Corporal Scott Pesca.
And I'm Petty Officer Christina Brockman. One of the benefits of being in the military is living on secure bases.
Overseas, security is even a bigger priority. And of course, if you don't have proper identification, you don't have access.
And that makes us think we're safe for the most part. But in reality, your home is vulnerable and your children may be in harm's way. The danger is email and the internet. The risk is enough to make any parent sit up and take notice.
We've seen a number of cases over the years since we started collecting data on internet-related crimes, specifically dealing with sexual predators and children. Unfortunately, we're finding that Navy Marine Corps children are not only being victimized by people inside the United States, but they're also being targeted by folks outside the United States.
And that's why Special Agent Matt Parsons created a program called Safe Kids. It's designed to give parents and teachers tools to recognize when there might be a problem.
Our personal goals are to ensure that Navy and Marine Corps families who are serving either inside or outside the United States are fully aware and enabled to protect their children on the internet.
Protecting children from the dangers of the internet may seem like an easy task, but for many parents, the internet is still foreign.
What some of the parents at this Family Advocacy Conference told me is that their kids are much more knowledgeable about the internet and this type of technology than they are, and they're afraid of it.
NCIS, working with DoD schools, teaches adults the basic computer skills needed to help protect children.
A lot of the parents stayed afterwards to learn how to copy files, to learn restricted access to the web, to learn how to pull up history files from their kids.
The program is still in its infancy, but the early classes have special agents confident in its success, and that makes Special Agent Parsons feel good about Safe Kids.
From parent to parent, I couldn't think of anything else that I wouldn't do for another person's child. I mean, that could be my child out there.
If you'd like more information, check out the website ncis.navy.mil/safekids/home.htm. You'll find out what things to look out for and important tips. The site also has free downloads of pamphlets, presentations, and software for parents. This is a really good program and well worth looking into. If you'd like to find out about a Safe Kids program near you, contact the nearest NCIS office.
Thanks, Jyoti. We're continuing to celebrate the Submarine Force Centennial, and coincidentally, Hollywood joined in when the movie U-571 hit the silver screen.
Petty Officer Nico Melendez takes us aboard USS Portsmouth as some of the stars of the movie went aboard for the ride of their lives.
Everything's in German!
I can't even believe the
dude! The action-packed submarine drama U-571 hit theaters last month, and sailors hope this glimpse into the silent service piques an interest in the Navy.
Any movie that really comes out about anything that has the Navy in it or any armed forces in it, it generates feelings from people that they're kind of like, wow, that might be kind of interesting.
Two cast members and the movie's director found the topic so compelling, they couldn't pass up an invitation to spend a day aboard USS Portsmouth.
So far everyone that I met is really cool, and it's great to get the opportunity to ask them about
you know, what it's like to be on a sub.
And the men found the similarities between today's submariners and those of World War II quite amazing.
Even though we're not, you know, at war or anything like that, the courage that they have to be able to withstand being on a sub for this, you know, that amount of time, I think people forget that, you know, that takes a lot of commitment.
Submariners are a real special bunch. They live in really extreme and extraordinary circumstances, and it breeds a certain kind of quality out of people. People are really nice. There's a great sort of casual feeling here, but when they get down to business, it's precise like a Swiss watch.
The visit was about Portsmouth sailors showing off their boat.
A lot of people don't know a whole lot about submarines, so it's good to have some people come down, see what it's like.
Every time I got to do something on the submarine today, I thought, this is the coolest thing I've ever done in my life. And then when I was finished with it, an officer would come over to me and say, okay, now come over here, we're gonna let you fire a torpedo or dive the boat or look through the periscope.
The cast and crew of U-571 say the feedback they've received from sailors makes them think they've created a hit movie.
It's very important to me how people in the military feel about the film, because we worked really hard to be as accurate as we possibly could. I hope that people in the military, people in the Navy, will go see the film and think that we got it right.
Those sentiments were echoed a couple of weeks later at the movie's premiere in Los Angeles.
Gentlemen, it's our turn. So to have the Navy's validation with this picture means more to us than the box office.
And one former Marine on hand expressed his feelings about those who served in submarines 50 years ago.
Dive, dive.
Truly it was a privilege for me to honor the heroic submariners of World War II. Their task was arduous, as you know. A number of them were killed in the service of this country, and still they came forward to volunteer to fight for this country's liberty when it was threatened.
Matthew McConaughey says this movie isn't just about history.
Step away from that bulkhead, Mr. Hirsch.
I haven't had to go to bed one time in the last 30 years wondering if I'm going to get that call in the morning, be called to the front line, because of wars like this where we were there for a good reason and we took care of business.
You're going to do your job, sailor.
Petty Officer Nico Melendez, Navy Marine Corps News.
Every one of us has the opportunity to become an organ donor.
That little check in the box on your driver's license could mean the difference between life and death for someone.
Corporal Dave Anarino introduces us to one Navy family who has been touched by this final act of giving.
This is 9-year-old Daniel Gray. When Daniel was only 10 months old, he was diagnosed with chronic kidney failure. His parents, Petty Officer Dan Gray and his wife Tina, well, they were devastated.
He was fed through a feeding tube and battled many other conditions caused from his failing kidneys. Doctors sustained his kidneys with medication to preserve what little amount of function they had until transplant was available.
Daniel spent the next 5 years consumed with doctor's visits and surgeries. Time was running out, and still, no donor.
Finally, the call that we had been so anxiously waiting for came one Halloween night in 1996.
They found a donor, Joni Marshall's son, Tommy, who died in a forklift accident that night.
I understood why Tommy wanted to be an organ donor. The gift he gave was the gift of life and the gift of love.
I wanted to thank Tommy and his family for giving me the opportunity to be able to play ball with my son, to go bike riding, to just do a lot of things that a lot of other people take for granted.
For years, Petty Officer Gray wondered how he could possibly show thanks to the family responsible for saving his son's life until the fall of 1999, when he saved a woman trapped on her mobile home during Hurricane Floyd. For his heroic actions, he was awarded the Navy and Marine Corps Medal.
I knew that when I received this medal, it would be passed on. The person that is my hero, unfortunately, couldn't be with us tonight.
AT-1 Gray said Tommy Marshall deserved it more than him.
He gave my son that second chance at life. He gave Daniel that kidney that he so desperately needed in order to sustain life. I received this medal for saving someone else's life. Therefore, I feel it is only appropriate to to pass this medal on to Joni in memory of Tommy.
We realize mere words, or even a medal for that matter, fall so short of expressing the deep gratitude for the gifts that you have so graciously given in your time of sorrow. Please believe me when I say your gift never goes unforgotten. I kiss mine every day.
Thank you for the kidney.
Certainly gives you something to think about.
Sure does. We'll be back in a moment.
Hello, shipmates. Mick Von Hurt here. Everyone that I've talked with in my travels around the fleet has heard me talk about leadership. Each and every one of us can be and is a leader in some form or another. You should expect to be a mentor to the sailors you supervise. Navy leaders must take an active role in growing sailors that will lead us through the 21st century. We shouldn't expect our junior shipmates to just gain leadership skills by chance. Any of us that has had a successful career can point to at least one mentor that stood out as someone we wanted to be just like. You should want to be that someone for your sailors. No matter how much we learn throughout our careers, it means nothing if we don't pass it on to our shipmates for tomorrow. Until next time, I'll see you about the fleet.
With the wrong glasses, this intersection can be absolutely deadly. And these are the wrong glasses.
Please, designate a driver.
Welcome back.
The basic school in Quantico, Virginia, takes newly commissioned officers and prepares them to be leaders in combat.
Recently, I spent some time with the enlisted Marines who train those officers, using the experience they've gained in the fleet.
This is Second Lieutenant Ryan Schaefer, and this is Second Lieutenant Matthew McDonald. They're recent officer candidate school graduates who have only been in the Marine Corps a few months. The basic school gives them the initial training in military warfighting tactics so they can be confident about taking Marines into combat.
Do me a favor and call up the CIs and give me some feedback on the attack.
And these are the Marine combat instructors from the basic school, who will make sure they will be able to lead others into harm's way.
Prior to coming here, I was at Fast Company. Was there for 2 years. Went to a scout sniper school in 98.
Sergeant Wood and the other instructors have years of field experience, and these NCOs put every bit of it into training future platoon commanders.
We need to make this happen.
This week, the officers train in offensive and defensive fire team maneuvers.
Roger, he's on his way. Over. We're going to provide 180 security here facing southwest. Roger.
The combat instructors test the new officers on every possible situation, from probing attacks to an all-out frontal assault.
The TBS instructors will use everything at their disposal, from fire team tactics to flares to explosives, to train these officers correctly so they can go out in the fleet and be leaders of Marines in combat.
They don't hold back on us being second lieutenants. They tell us when, hey, that maneuver by fire was not what it should have been. So they don't hold back, and it helps us learn the real way to do it.
These enlisted Marines are training the future leaders of the Corps, and they know how these lieutenants perform out in the fleet is a direct reflection on how well they've done.
They don't just push everybody through, and I'm satisfied with the Marines that I've worked with that have gone through IOC, that I know once I get out to the fleet, I'll be happy and I'll feel comfortable and confident working for them.
The combat instructors and the officers they train have a deep respect for what each is doing.
Even if you're someone's boss, you can still learn from them.
USS Frank Cable sailors are making the most of being stationed overseas while their ship is being overhauled.
They're taking in the sights and culture of Guam and having some fun. Petty Officer Aaron Blodgett from our San Diego detachment has more.
The crew of USS Frank Cable in Guam spends more than half the year underway. That's why maintaining a high quality of life for these overseas sea duty sailors and their families is so important.
Actually, the ship has a very good schedule. When we're in port in Guam, we're in 10-section duty, so that allows you 9 days, actually 9 nights at home with your family, or 9 days to go out and experience Guam's culture and the different things that you can do on the island.
Like experiencing a Chamorro-style luau, complete with plenty of seafood, singing, and dancing. The year-round 85-degree weather in Guam also provides Frank Cable sailors with plenty of opportunities to explore the ocean.
We do a lot of swimming, which is one place thing about Guam is the swimming's great.
I mean, snorkeling.
All year round. All of our kids started swimming, they were just a few months old, so I mean, they love the water.
And like many places in the world, sailors can always go downtown to help take the edge off a tough work day. Of life involves more than just making sure morale is high. It's also important that the crew's working and living needs are met. Ever hear of single sailors living in on-base housing other than the barracks? The Frank Cable is currently being overhauled, leaving the ship uninhabitable with the exception of the work centers. And once the work is done, the sailors might get to stay where they are.
It's great. I like it better than coming home. I'd rather leave the boat and come here and be able to lay down and relax instead of having to go downstairs to berthing and share the television with like 30 other people. We try to keep each other in line. We try to look out for each other because everybody would love to stay here.
From Guam, Petty Officer Aaron Blodgett, Navy Marine Corps News.
USS Mobile Bay sailors recently got some hands-on training from the Afloat Training Group in Yokosuka, Japan. Petty Officer Rita Chadrick has the story.
A helicopter crashed on their flight deck, and it's up to these USS Mobile Bay sailors to combat the blaze and save the pilot and crew. Luckily, it's just a scenario, part of the Hilo firefighting training at Afloat Training Group Western Pacific in Yokosuka, Japan.
We always do training on the ship, but you can never get the feeling of it until you've been out here and you can actually fight the fire and see how hot it is.
It is very important for us to come here and do the real thing so that whenever we go back to our ship and something happens, there's no surprises. We're all prepared and we all know what to do. We all know our assignments.
We try to reduce as much sedation as possible because when the time comes time for them to make actual rescues, they will realize or remember the training that they had was provided for them at the school.
Whether fighting a real or mock fire, safety is always at the forefront.
I can't overemphasize the importance because one mistake, a pilot can get killed, a host team member can get killed from an ordnance blowing up. Bottom line is there is no corners to be cut when you're firefighting or doing any kind of job.
Keep your eyes open, keep checking on your guys, making sure everybody's doing the proper procedures, a lot of training. That's all you can do is keep training for safety.
No one can predict when a Hilo will crash, but if it does, sailors on the Mobile Bay are trained and ready. From Yokosuka, Japan, I'm Petty Officer Rita Chadrick, Navy Marine Corps News.
A new Guaranteed Assignment Retention Detailing Program, or GARD program, is offering sailors more reasons to stay Navy.
GARD 2000 allows sea tour waivers of up to 18 months for some first-term sailors, and it gives detailers greater flexibility in assigning sailors to lower priority billets.
For more information, check out navadmin083/00.
Stick around. When we come back, we'll take a look at sailors swinging to a Latin beat on the TV dance show Caliente.
Stay tuned.
Mayday! Mayday! Watch out! The May. All hands is out. You have 30 seconds to get your copy.
the May edition of All Hands Magazine. Get your copy today.
Sailors aboard USS Incheon recently got the chance to be on the Latin TV dance show Caliente.
And that's because the show was aired from the flight deck of the ship. Petty Officer Miranda Williams has the story.
USS Incheon sailors hosted a special taping for the Spanish-speaking dance show Caliente recently. Some sailors chosen to dance for the show were happy to show off their best salsa and merengue moves.
Since I've been little, I've always wanted to be in Caliente, and I've always watched it on television. And I always said, Mommy, I want to dance salsa merengue on television. And this finally gave me an opportunity to. We're just out there having a good time, smiling, keeping our faces up, and just enjoying what we're doing.
For many, dancing on the show is a good way to show Navy pride.
I've always danced salsa and merengue, and I enjoy it. And I feel it's an opportunity for us to show off our boat.
Show coordinators were excited about the opportunity to shoot on USS Incheon.
Something I've never done before. I've done a lot of crazy stuff with this program, but this is one definitely new experience, and I think it's a very, very cool experience.
Whether they danced for Navy pride or to fulfill a childhood dream, one thing is certain. USS Incheon sailors dance the day away. From USS Incheon in Ingleside, Texas, I'm Petty Officer Miranda Williams, Navy Marine Corps News.
From a TV dance show to a game show.
The game is called Paranoia, and it's the first live, interactive, multiplayer TV game show with participants playing via the internet, by phone, and from live remote cameras.
And one of those cameras was aimed at a sailor aboard USS Constellation.
Petty Officer Chris Robinson tells us more.
That you get on the show, but one of the ways to help you get on the show is to have a big personality. You must have a big smile on your face. I know we don't go through life as happy as this all the time and jolly, but that's what makes a game show player interesting.
First time a game show has ever gone live to air with a satellite hookup in 9 other parts of the country. You have a studio player, you have 3 home players, you have the internet people playing at the same time. You've also got to have a fabulous backdrop, and what better backdrop than the top deck of an aircraft carrier.
In order to get a shot to play the game, Petty Officer Barksdale competed with fellow sailors in 3 categories. A written test, a mock version of the game,
traditionally throw on the ice,
and a personal interview. So after passing the test and the judge's short debate, he was chosen to represent his ship. So, no pressure, right?
My goal is just to get up there and always do my best, put on a good show, and for the most part, represent the Navy as best as I can.
So after setting up the remote and a uniform change, it was time to play the game Paranoia and win some big bucks.
I say it's B.
Petty Officer Barksdale lasted into the second round before getting knocked out, but he didn't go away empty-handed.
I walked out of here with $1,000 and a new home computer, so I feel real good about it. I think the Navy really prepares you for that because you do so much training for the real deal. And once it did come down to that, hey, I was training up and just got concentrated down and was ready to do the job.
Now with it all over, the only thing Petty Officer Barksdale has to prepare for is keeping his shipmates away from his wallet.
I gotta run out of here, though.
From aboard USS Constellation, Petty Officer Chris Robinson, Navy Marine Corps News.
Petty Officer Barksdale was one of 3 remote players competing against the in-studio contestant.
Well, Cyber is back, and he's been talking about a brand new site that is getting ready to open on the internet.
In fact, it's all he's been talking about. And since he sees a lot of sites, it sounds like this is one you'll want to write down.
Take it away, Cyber Sailor.
Ugh. There's a new Lifelines in town. It's bigger, faster, and more dynamic. Lifelines2000.org is setting the standard for all future websites. No one else can match their news center, which is updated every week with the latest military news around the world. If you're searching for a specific kind of news, then go to the side column where you'll see a list of over 20 different categories to choose from. Then go to one of the most fascinating parts of Lifelines 2000, where you can see live streaming video at the click of a mouse. Here you can watch the MCPON Minute, the latest DTS Daily News Update, Health Beat, Focus on the Fleet, a video of Anthrax, the Survival Benefits Program, and me. They put three of my cyber sailors on there. Lifelines 2000 is willing to take any news story you have on video at any time, no matter where you're located in the entire world, as long as it's military related. The people at Lifelines are so enthused about keeping their site packed with streaming video. If that didn't get your attention, maybe the business portal will. Here, you'll be amazed by the number of e-commerce resources to keep you up to date with the fast-growing world of business on the internet. Plus, it has different support zones for housing, medical, money matters, core values, being single or married in the military, and ways to improve your schooling. This site is ridiculously huge, and it doesn't just have information you can use. They also have postcards to be sent over the internet, different polls you can take part in, and a quote of the day. Okay, pick your career field. Whether you're active duty, reserves, or civilian, these different links will provide you with the best information for your career. If you have questions, visit a forum where other military members have left answers, or visit the index page where you can find the answer firsthand through the Lifelines 2000 website. Keep your eye on the ball and check back to this site every day for the latest news and information in the military. Lifelines2000.org has a lot planned for this site, and you want to be the first when they break new ground. If you have any other sites you'd like to see on the show or questions you'd like me to answer, send them to me. CyberSailor@mediasend.navy.mil. I'm Petty Officer Joe Hendricks, Navy Marine Corps News.
Wow, you'd think he was excited about it or something.
Just a little bit. By the way, the new Lifelines is scheduled to be online Memorial Day. And just in case you missed it, the address is lifelines2000.org.
Well, that's the show for this week.
We'd like your comments and suggestions. The email address will be up again at the end of the show, along with our phone number.
We'd like to say hello and thanks for watching to our viewers in Wheat Ridge, Colorado, who watch us every week on local channel 22.
We leave you this week with a look at USS Frank Cable sailors in Guam.
Until next week.
Take care.
We've seen a number of cases over the years since we started collecting data on internet-related crimes, specifically dealing with sexual predators and children. Unfortunately, we're finding that Navy Marine Corps children are not only being victimized by people inside the United States, but they're also by folks outside the United States.
And that's why Special Agent Matt Parsons created a program called Safe Kids. It's designed to give parents and teachers tools to recognize when there might be a problem.
Our personal goals are to ensure that Navy and Marine Corps families who are serving either inside or outside the United States are fully aware and enabled to protect their children on the internet.
Protecting children from the dangers of the internet may seem like an easy task, but for many parents, the internet is still foreign.
What some of the parents at this Family Advocacy Conference told me is that their kids are much more knowledgeable about the internet and technology than they are, and they're afraid of it.
NCIS, working with DoD schools, teaches adults the basic computer skills needed to help protect children.
A lot of the parents stayed afterwards to learn how to copy files, to learn restricted access to the web, to learn how to pull up history files from their kids.
The program is still in its infancy, but the early classes have special agents confident in its success, and that makes Special Agent Parsons feel good about Safe Kids.
From parent to parent, I couldn't think of anything else that I wouldn't do for another person's child. I mean, that could be my child out there.
If you'd like more information, check out the website ncis.navy.mil/safekids/home.htm. You'll find out what things to look out for and important tips. The site also has free downloads of pamphlets, presentations, and software for parents.
This is 9-year-old Daniel Gray. When Daniel was only 10 months old, he was diagnosed with chronic kidney failure. His parents, Petty Officer Dan Gray and his wife Tina, well, they were devastated.
He was fed through a feeding tube and battled many other conditions caused from his failing kidneys. Doctors sustained his kidneys with medication to preserve what little amount of function they had until transplant was available.
Daniel spent the next 5 years consumed with doctor's visits and surgeries. Time was running out, and still no donor.
Finally, the call that we had been so anxiously waiting for came one Halloween night in 1996.
They found a donor, Joni Marshall's son, Tommy, who died in a forklift accident that night.
I understood why Tommy wanted to be an organ donor. The gift he gave was the gift of life and the gift of love.
I wanted to thank Tommy and his family for giving me the opportunity to be able to play ball with my son, to go bike riding, to just do a lot of things that a lot of other people take for granted.
For years, Petty Officer Gray wondered how he could possibly show thanks to the family responsible for saving his son's life until the fall of 1999, when he saved a woman trapped on her mobile home during Hurricane Floyd. For his heroic actions, he was awarded the Navy and Marine Corps Medal.
I knew that when I received this medal, it would be passed on. The person that is my hero, unfortunately, couldn't be with us tonight.
AT1 Gray said Tommy Marshall deserved it more than him.
He gave my son that second chance at life. He gave Daniel that kidney that he so desperately needed in order to sustain life. I received this medal for saving someone else's life. Therefore, I feel it is only appropriate to pass this medal on to Joni in memory of Tommy.
We realize mere words, or even a medal for that matter, fall so short of expressing the deep gratitude for the gifts that you have so graciously given in your time of sorrow. Please believe me when I say your gift never goes unforgotten. I kiss mine every day.
Thank you for the kidney.
This is Second Lieutenant Ryan Schaefer, and this is Second Lieutenant Matthew McDonald. They're recent Officer Candidate School graduates who have only been in the Marine Corps a few months. The basic school gives them the initial training in military warfighting tactics so they can be confident about taking Marines into combat.
Do me a favor and call up the CIs and give me some feedback on the attack.
And these are the Marine combat instructors from the basic school who will make sure they will be able to lead others into harm's way.
Prior to coming here, I was at FAST Company. Was there for 2 years. Went to a scout sniper school in 98.
Sergeant Wood and the other instructors have years of field experience, and these NCOs put every bit of it into training future platoon commanders.
We need to make this happen.
This week, the officers train in offensive and defensive fire team maneuvers.
Roger, he's on his way. Over. We're going to provide 180 security here facing southwest. Roger.
The combat instructors test the new officers on every possible situation, from probing attacks to an all-out frontal assault.
The TBS instructors will use everything at their disposal, from fireteam tactics to flares to explosives, to train these officers correctly so they can go out in the fleet and be leaders of Marines in combat.
They don't hold back on us being second lieutenants. They tell us when, hey, that maneuver by fire was not what it should have been. So they don't hold back, and it helps us learn the real way to do it.
These enlisted Marines are training the future leaders of the Corps, and they know how these lieutenants perform out in the fleet is a direct reflection on how well they've done.
They don't just push everybody through. And I'm satisfied with the Marines that I've worked with that have gone through IOC, that I know once I get out to the fleet, I'll be happy and I'll feel comfortable and confident working for them.
The combat instructors and the officers they train have a deep respect for what each is doing.
I want them to remember what it's like to be a PFC out here carrying a big saw.
The officers at the basic school learn combat skills, but they also learn another important lesson.
Even if you're someone's boss, you can still learn from them.
Saw.
This year's Sea Air Space Exposition once again gave exhibitors a chance to show off some of their new hardware and provide sailors and Marines a window into the future. From new ships to new aircraft, Sea Air Space had it all. Sailors at the convention say they're excited about what the future has in store.
Well, the Navy's going to be a whole lot better. It's going to be more technology. We're already the best Navy there is on Earth. It'll be a whole lot better.
Some of the technology at the exhibit is already being tested in the fleet and already making life easier for sailors, like the smart card. The smart card helps eliminate watches and gives commands the chance to increase the number of duty sections while decreasing watches. How does it work?
Sailor comes on board, he scans his card, it logs him on board the ship. When he gets ready to depart the ship, he scans his card and he departs the ship. It's going to start moving away from so many paper reports, such as muster reports and stuff. They're going to do it electronically.
And sailors say they like what they see.
This is my first time here, and it was real informative.
And some improvements are less high-tech, like this watertight door that will cut down on the workload of sailors.
The new door is going to help sailors by reducing the number of parts and the number of times they have to change parts.
And of course, sailors want to know when this will hit the fleet.
We actually have some of the new improved hinges now in the fleet. Six ships have been converted, and we'll be converting them very rapidly this year. We hope to get to 50 more ships in this calendar year, and we'll be continuing that over the next few years until we've done all the ships.
Is there anything else the fleet can expect in the near future?
What we have here is this is distance support. Distance support is a concept of bringing together all the various pieces of information that is residing on the shore side to help the sailor at sea. It's a one-stop shop portal. If you got a problem, bring it to us. We will get you an answer in a rapid manner.
And what will this new website do to make life easier for sailors at sea?
It'll help the efficiency by the fleet by making information more readily available.
Overall, sailors who visited Sea Air Space say the new hardware on display was a real eye-opener.
It was very interesting. There's a lot of new technology coming out. It's going to be a more advanced Navy, and people have to get on board.
From the Sea Air Space Exposition in Washington, D.C., Petty Officer Nico Melendez, Navy Marine Corps News.
USS Inchon sailors hosted a special taping for the Spanish-speaking dance show Caliente recently. Some sailors chosen to dance for the show were happy to show off their best salsa and merengue moves.
Since I've been little, I've always wanted to be in Caliente, and I've always watched it on television. And I always said, Mommy, I want to dance salsa merengue on television. And this finally gave me an opportunity to. We're just out there having a good time, smiling, keeping our faces up, and just enjoying what we're doing.
For many, dancing on the show is a good way to show Navy pride.
I've always danced salsa and merengue, and I enjoy it. And I feel it's an opportunity for us to show off our boat.
Show coordinators were excited about the opportunity to shoot on USS Inchon.
Something I've never done before. I've done a lot of crazy stuff with this program, but this is one definitely new experience, and I think it's a very, very cool experience.
Whether they danced for Navy pride or to fulfill a childhood dream, one thing is certain. USS Inchon sailors danced the day away. From USS Inchon in Ingleside, Texas, I'm Petty Officer Miranda Williams, Navy Marine Corps News.
A helicopter crashed on their flight deck, and it's up to these USS Mobile Bay sailors to combat the blaze and save the pilot and crew. Luckily, it's just a scenario, part of the Hilo firefighting training at Afloat Training Group Western Pacific in Yokosuka, Japan.
You always do training on the ship, but you can never get the feeling of it until you've been out here and you can actually fight the fire and see how hot it is.
It is very important for us to come here and do the real thing so that whenever we go back to our ship and something happens, there's no surprises. We're all prepared and we all know what to do. We all know our assignments.
We try to reduce as much simulation as possible because when the time comes time for them to make actual rescues, they will realize or remember the training that they had was provided for them at the school.
Whether fighting a real or mock fire, safety is always at the forefront.
I can't overemphasize the importance because one mistake, a pilot can get killed, a host team member can get killed from an ordnance blowing up. Bottom line is there is no corners to be cut when you're firefighting or doing any kind of job.
Keep your eyes open, keep checking on your guys, making sure everybody's doing the proper procedures, a lot of training. That's all you can do is keep training for safety.
No one can predict when a Hilo will crash, but if it does, sailors on the Mobile Bay are trained and ready. From Yokosuka, Japan, I'm Petty Officer Rita Chadwick, Navy Marine Corps News.
It's just out of water. It's just out of water.